Hello everyone, this is Nitpicking Nerd, and I just watched the new episode of Star Trek Discovery. Oh my god, you know, season 1 was pretty bad, but it had some moments which were neat, which were interesting or fun to see. Like, I did like a few things in season 1. I loved Captain Lorca, and also some of the Mirror Universe episodes were kind of fun, you know, when Michael had to pretend to be from that universe and to kill that guy in the elevator and then take command. So it did have some cool moments and some fun visuals and so on. So it wasn't this bad, but season 2, it started out good, and I kind of had the hope that maybe it will be improving. Like, all the Star Trek shows improved, they were all pretty bad in their first season, and you know, the second episode of season 2 really felt like a Star Trek episode. It had that kind of spirit, but after that the show has been on a decline story-wise. I'm not talking about the special effects, you know, some of the special effects are good, obviously very expensive, obviously with new technology, and so I'm not talking visually, but story-wise and character-wise this show is just terrible. And you know, now I understand the short track, the one about Saru's planet. I actually praised it. I thought, you know, it has some high production value. They actually had to build that village. They had to prep that beach to be the different colors. So I actually praised that short track. But now I realize it was probably filmed together with this episode. So they did it at the same time. And also, if you didn't watch the short track, you'll probably be confused in this episode. You won't understand what's even going on. And I'm not even going to waste time trying to analyze it or to come up with excuses. You know, I was defending the show a lot of times when it did things which don't make any sense. I was making up excuses to try to explain it, to try to fit it with other Star Trek shows, or even its internal continuity is also terrible a lot of times. So the whole thing with Saru's people don't make any sense now. They told us that they were biologically a prey species, that's why they had all those instincts. They gave them those legs which look like, you know, horse or cow legs, so indicating that they're like a domesticated animal, and they had all those biological features of a prey species rather than predator. But then in the short track they introduced the Ba'ul, which didn't make any sense, and they violated the Prime Directive because Captain Georgiou took him from his planet. And I said in my review of that short track that it's so stupid to take him away because he's the son of the priest, and so if the priest dies, then he can become the next priest, and if he's so clever, maybe he'll evolve his people. And in this episode we find out that his father died immediately after he left, and so this makes it even worse. And none of it really makes sense. I mean, the Red Angel is leading them from place to place, and how convenient is it that just after Saru discovered the truth about his nature, that immediately after that the Red Angel makes them come to his planet? Immediately after, such a lucky coincidence for the story. Captain Pike even mentions that, what a coincidence. And you know, I heard in some parody, I think it was in Stargate, they did a parody saying that if you make something very convenient in your script, which is basically lazy writing, but if you have one of the characters mention that fact, then it makes it okay. And so that's kind of what happened in this episode. So what a coincidence this is, that just after Saru happened to discover the biological truth about himself, because of some random event, by the way, they met that sphere not because of the Red Angel. So you can't even use that as an excuse, because, you know, if the Red Angel is leading them from place to place with some kind of a purpose and design, then maybe it's okay, maybe it makes sense in the grand scheme of things. But they met that sphere completely by accident. It didn't have anything to do with the Red Angel. And so what a lucky coincidence that just after this they happen to locate the Red Angel next to that planet, so they have to go there. So this is very ridiculously lazy writing, the way they connect each episode to each other. And they had Pike actually mention this fact. So Pike himself says, oh, what a nice coincidence. So this really reminded me of that scene in Stargate in which they made fun of this kind of lazy writing. By having one of the characters say that, that somehow makes it okay, as if they're self-aware of how lazy they're writing. So this really made me laugh. A lot of things in this episode were unintentional comedy to me. And you know, the whole thing with Section 31, I'll probably do a whole video just about Section 31, and I thought about making up excuses, I thought about how I can explain what they did in the previous episode by making Section 31 public knowledge, that everyone in Starfleet knows about Section 31 as if it's their FBI or CIA or something like that, and not some kind of secret organization that no one knew about. Remember, Bashir said that he never heard about it, and that it's a rogue organization that doesn't work for Starfleet. in Discovery we see that it is working with Starfleet and everybody knows about it. And I thought about making a long video to try to explain it by saying, you know, it's a prequel, maybe things change, maybe Bashir doesn't know his history, maybe it's not a rogue organization, maybe even in Deep Space Nine time they only pretend it's a rogue organization as not to assume responsibility on the Federation and Starfleet. And that way it can do whatever nasty thing they want to do. So I was going to make like a serious video try to defend that point, but the show itself doesn't care. So we have Ash Tyler back on the Discovery, and he's now a Section 31 agent, and he keeps saying that everywhere inside public places on the ship. Oh, Section 31 this, Section 31 that. He probably mentioned Section 31 at least 5 times in this episode, and he's wearing the normal uniform now, but with that black badge, which is also a communicator, which I don't have a huge problem with. I saw a lot of people complain about that. You know, it's not such a big technological leap to have a communicator installed in a comm badge, so I don't really have a problem with this specific point. I mean, we can do something like that today, so it's not really a problem, so I didn't want to complain about that point. But I do find it hilarious how Ash Tyler is now behaving as if he's been with Section 31 for years. The way he talks, the way he speaks for them, it's as if he's been a member of Section 31 for a very long time, but he just joined them yesterday. He shouldn't even know anything about them. I mean, just a few days ago, like 2 episodes ago, he joined Section 31. They recruited him for some unknown reason, like I don't even get why. He's also a Klingon, basically, so why would they do that? It doesn't make any sense if you think about it. And now he pretends as if he speaks for them, as if he's been a member of Section 31 for years. So I found it ridiculous. I find it just hilarious. So anyway, the Red Angel now appears next to Saru's planet, so they go there, how convenient. And also, that guy on the bridge who I call Mr. No Response, he again says no response. He says that at least twice in this episode, and they just crack up every time. I made a compilation of him on my other channel, showing all the scenes in which he just says no response. So I probably should add these new clips as well. I just found it hilarious, and he never waits, like, immediately he hails someone and no response. But if someone hails them, then they can sometimes debate about it and wait for a few minutes before answering. So this is something which was also in the older Star Trek shows, so I made fun of that. But twice in one episode I see Mr. No Response, and of course he has no other duties, he's only the random communication officer, so it's pretty ridiculous. And the resurrected doctor, who they got back in the previous episode magically, and they say he has a brand new body because his body has been cloned basically with his DNA, like, it doesn't really make sense. Why did he have his DNA in the spore dimension? I mean, his body never went there. And you know, that brand new body, he must have been working out, because he looks kind of muscular. So if he has a brand new body, why does he have such big muscles? And why did he have hair when he reappeared? Like, shouldn't he be bald if it's a brand new body which just grew? Then either he should have hair everywhere or have hair nowhere. But he has that exact right haircut that he had before, so did the spores give him the exact haircut he wanted? Like, it doesn't make any sense. It's as if they're not even trying to make sense of it visually, so just a terrible plot line in my opinion. So anyway, they arrive to Saru's planet and they discover the Ba'ul, who did look kind of cool. Like, that's the only thing I actually liked in this episode, that visually the Ba'ul did look kind of interesting. Their ships looked kind of creepy, the way their voice sounded was creepy, and they even showed one of them, and that looked kind of creepy and interesting, but also ridiculous, and also very similar to a lot of other things. Just like this show loves to do, it loves to steal visual ideas from other science fiction movies, and in this case horror movies, I guess, because that Ba'ul looked kind of like a cross between Venom and that girl from the movie The Ring, you know, with the black hair over her eyes. And so that looked like a cross between all of that and a little bit of Armos, you know, that gooey black creature that rolls out of a pool. So it looked a little bit like that, and also mixed with Venom and mixed with the girl from The Ring, all of it together in one creature. And it was just shown, I guess, to look cool and to put it in the trailers, because it really didn't serve anything for the story, as often is done in this show. They only show us cool things just to look cool without any actual purpose to it. The story itself was totally ridiculous. Saru somehow manages to beam out of the ship, even though the shields are up. I mean, they are at red alert, they are preparing for battle, so presumably the shields are up. I think they actually said the shields are up. So how is he even able to beam himself over? We don't know even where. I guess he beams himself into the ships of the Ba'ul. And then they show him in the room, which looks exactly like the same room as the transporter room. So it's as if it's the same exact set. They only redressed it a little bit. They made the walls look dark. But you can tell it's the same exact set. You see the same exact stairs. So it felt very noticeable. And I know in Star Trek they always reuse the same sets, but usually they do it in a way, in ways that you don't notice it. But this was so noticeable, it really was laughable, because he was just in this room. He beamed from this room into the same exact room, only with the dark walls. And then this Armus, Venom, Rin girl rise up from that pool and make a speech to him. And why? Why even do that if you just intend to kill him? So why are you needing to explain your evil plan to him or what? And then Saru somehow magically manages to escape and defeat their technology with his body. This is terrible. And then they get the information from the sphere to learn about the species, and then they somehow recreate what the sphere did to activate that thing in the Saru's people so that everyone will become like him. And they reveal that they're actually the predator species originally, that their evolution leads them, they become from prey into predator right away, and the Va'ul are actually scared of them. And why are they scared of them if they have such superior technology? But I guess if their technology is so fragile that Saru is able to break it with his bare hands, maybe it makes sense. And then the funniest thing in this whole episode, Saru takes the debris from those devices he broke and somehow magically constructs a communicator out of them. So I really bursted out laughing when I saw that. Like, he magically builds a communicator out of nothing to contact the Discovery. So really the only thing I liked is how the Ba'ul looked kind of cool and creepy and have a creepy voice, but they turned out to be totally pathetic. So they're scared of Saru's people. So why didn't they simply wipe them out? Why did they simply destroy all of them when they could? What's the point to keep them suppressed in this way? So now they're planning to commit genocide, and then Captain Pike wants to attack them because of that. And then the Red Angel appears and saves everyone. So why didn't he just do it right away? If the Red Angel wants to save these people, why did it even need the Discovery? And probably most likely it's Michael from the future. Of course, why not? And they show the Ba'ul rising out from the ocean, and their giant ship looks exactly like the mothership of Anubis from Stargate. It looks almost identical. So really, this show is stealing up visual stuff from other places. It has no originality, it has no creativity of its own, I guess. It has to look like something else always. And then they say they want to commit genocide against the Kelpians, and then the way Michael says that is really hilarious. Her delivery in the last few episodes was just laughably bad, just ridiculous. And then Pike says, "Hell those bastards." It was fun, it was unintentional comedy. So that's the only good thing about this show, I guess. I laughed at it. And of course the communication guy says no response, of course. So the Red Angel, I guess, disables Anubis' mothership so that he doesn't destroy the Kelpians, and that's it. So there is no threat from them anymore. So nothing really is resolved, nothing is explored. It's just lazy. They move on, now they go to Vulcan for some unknown reason, and I guess there she will finally meet Spock, because we still didn't see Spock in this entire show. And in the footage of the next episode, now we see those squid robots from The Matrix. So that's what they will rip off next, I guess. So we see the exact same kind of visual effects, like those squid robots from The Matrix movies, and also kind of looking like Dr. Octopus from Spider-Man, the way those arms move around and so on. So this is really another example of this show stealing visual cool scenes from other places because they have no original ideas of their own. So just terrible. Absolutely ridiculous. And Ash Tyler keeps saying, Section 31, Section 31. They want this, they want that. You don't know them, you just joined them yesterday. So why is he talking as if he's been a member of their section for years? So just ridiculous. Absolutely ridiculous. So I think I'm going to end this review here because I'm seriously getting annoyed. So, in short, everything in this episode was absolutely ridiculous, and it's just the show is getting worse and worse, in my opinion. And the Section 31 thing, I'll probably do a whole separate video just on that, just to cover all of it and to really poke fun at it even more. So, that's it for now. Let me know what you think in the comments below, and we can discuss it, and I will see you guys next time. Bye-bye.